Penguin Random House Audio presents A Kiss Before Dying by Pamela Colloff from Texas Monthly, February 2006. Read for you by Staci Snell with Karissa Vacker. When football season ended, and there was nothing much to do on Friday nights except drink beer and stare up at the wide open sky, teenagers used to park their pickups across the street from Odessa High School and wait to see the ghost they called Betty. According to legend, she would appear at the windows of the school auditorium at midnight, provided that students flashed their headlights 3 times or honked their horn and called out her name. The real Betty, it was said, had attended Odessa High decades before and had acted in a number of plays on the auditorium stage. But the facts of her death had been muddled with time, and each story was as apocryphal as the last. She had fallen off a ladder in the auditorium and broken her neck, students said. She had hanged herself in the theater. Her boyfriend, who was a varsity football player, had shot her on stage during a play. So many teenagers made the late-night pilgrimage to see Betty that the high school deemed it prudent to paint over the windows of the school auditorium. During a later renovation, its facade was covered with bricks. But the stories about Betty never went away. Students still talk of a presence in the auditorium, one that is to blame for a long list of strange occurrences, from flickering lights and noises that cannot be explained to objects that appear to move on their own. Some claim to have seen her pacing the balcony or heard her footsteps behind them, only to find no one there. Rumors have flourished that a coach who knew the real Betty is visited by her on occasion in the field house, and that a former vice principal who once caught a glimpse of her after hours was so spooked by the encounter that he refused to be in the school again by himself. "I hear her name on a daily basis," says theater arts teacher Carl Moore, who has taught at Odessa High for 4 years. "Whenever something unexplained happens, a book falls on the floor in my classroom, or the light board goes out during a technical rehearsal, someone always jokes, 'It's Betty.'" What may be nothing more than just a ghost story can also be seen as something more complicated, as a metaphor, perhaps, for the way that one crime has lodged uneasily in Odessa's collective memory. The teenagers who pass down stories about Betty are too young to remember the kiss and kill murder, as it was christened by the press in 1961, but it was the most sensational crime in West Texas in its day. The notoriety of the case has long since faded, yet 45 years later, something lingers. When Ronnie White, who graduated from Odessa High the year that the murder took place, returned to his alma mater to teach history in 1978, he was astonished to hear students talking about the former drama student named Betty, whose spirit supposedly haunted the auditorium, and the popular football player who had had a hand in her killing. "I couldn't believe what I was hearing," he says. "I thought, good Lord, they must be talking about Betty Williams."
September 23rd, 1960. Study hall. Well, I finally made the rank of senior, and I can hardly believe it. I really don't feel much different. We get our senior rings Wednesday. I'll be glad. It sure does feel funny to be on the top of everything looking down. Seems strange to think that this is really all of high school. Next year? We had our pictures made last week. If they turn out halfway decent, I'll send you one. Send me another picture if you have it. Well, the bell is about to ring, so I'll write more later. Love, Betty.
What most people remember about Betty Williams is that they hardly noticed her at all. She lived in a small, well-worn frame house on an unpaved street, not far from the oil fields west of town, where gas flares burned and drilling rig lights illuminated the desert at night. Her father, John, was a carpenter who had difficulty finding steady work, and her mother, Mary, had taken a job at JCPenney to help make ends meet. A strict Baptist, her father often preached to Betty about sin and eternal damnation, and on more than one Sunday morning, he prayed that she might learn to be a more obedient daughter. At 17, Betty was pretty in an unremarkable way, with sandy blonde hair that brushed her shoulders and big, expressive blue eyes that could feign sincerity when talking to authority figures, but were alive with irreverence. Betty disdained conformity and reserved particular contempt for the girls with matching sweater sets and saddle shoes who seemed to look right through her. She fancied herself an intellectual and put down her opinions on everything from boys to religion in dozens of letters and notes that she passed in study hall. She read Jack Kerouac's On the Road and the poetry of Allen Ginsberg, and she listened to records of Lenny Bruce's stand-up routines in which he railed against racism and skewered middle-class hypocrisy. She, too, liked to get a rise out of people, and she thrived on attention, whether she got it by arriving at Tommy's drive-in dressed entirely in black but wearing white lipstick, or in jeans and a t-shirt, under which she didn't bother to put on a bra. She freely expressed opinions that went against the grain, like her belief that segregation was unjust and that blacks should not have to attend a separate high school across the railroad tracks. In bedrock conservative blue-collar Odessa, where the John Birch Society's crusade against communism and other un-American influences had struck a chord, she was seen as an oddball. "Most people do not understand me," Betty wrote to a friend her senior year. "There are people willing to be my friends, but mostly they are either too ignorant to understand why I'm like I am, and consequently offer my mind no challenge, or they haven't the wits to match mine." At the top of Odessa High School's rigid social hierarchy were the Kashmir girls, as one alumna called them, the girls with perfect complexions from West Odessa's better neighborhoods who were perennially voted most popular, best personality, and class favorite. At football games, they sat in the stands wearing the ultimate status symbol, their boyfriend's letter jackets. They belonged to the informal sororities called Tri-High Y Clubs, Capri, Sorella, and Amake, which cherry-picked the most popular high school girls. Betty was hardly Tri-High Y material. In the high school pecking order, her classmates remember her as a nobody, a non-entity, and someone on the outside looking in. But while she struck an anti-establishment pose, the rejection she felt from the other girls still stung. "Betty wanted to be liked," says her first cousin, Shelton Williams, whose memoir, Washed in the Blood, chronicles his coming of age in Odessa through the prism of Betty's murder. She wanted what we all want, to be totally unique while being completely accepted. In a place where fun on a Saturday night might mean deciding to take only right turns while cruising around town, Betty dreamed of her escape. She hoped to one day become an actress, and in her bedroom, where movie posters and playbills covered the walls, she devoured magazines like the Hollywood scandal sheet Confidential. She loved the thrill of the spotlight and was gifted enough that she landed parts in 3 school plays when she was just a sophomore. During her junior year, when the speech team performed the balcony scene from Romeo and Juliet at the University Interscholastic League competition, Betty played the doomed lovesick heroine. But as desperately as she wanted to propel herself out of Odessa, she was fatalistic about the future. The oldest of 4 children, she knew that her parents could not afford to send her away to college, and her part-time job at Woolworth's barely paid enough to finance any kind of getaway. While she aspired to one day appear on the Broadway stage, in the meantime, she planned to live at home after graduation and attend Odessa College just up the street. Some nights, Betty would slip out the back door after her parents had gone to bed and walk the 4 blocks to Tommy's drive-in, where there were always boys to talk to. Plenty of girls were flirts, but few of them were as assertive as Betty. She made no secret of the fact that she was not a prude, and that she was willing to prove it. At the end of an evening at Tommy's, it was not unusual for her to end up parked in a secluded spot somewhere with a football player, after, of course, he had taken his girlfriend home to meet her curfew. While boys were free to do as they pleased, good girls were expected to obey an unspoken code of conduct. If a girl had a steady boyfriend, then she could have sex, as long as she didn't advertise it.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.